church to preach that word, those words, because if I tell a parishioner of mine to do something that means he or she will make less money, then the 10% of his money or her money that I'm going to give is smaller. What do we do with that? What do we do with the reality that the financial interests of the church are so unaligned with the financial interests of the world? How do we get past that? There's something worse than that, and that is when preachers are afraid of preaching things that will cause their members to what?
Leave.
We have been carefully taught all of our lives to not talk about money. Some people have more. I don't want to talk to people who have more money than I do because they're going to think something bad about me. Some people have less. Well, I don't want to talk to people who have less money than I do because I don't want to embarrass them. They might want what I have. They might be uncomfortable, and God knows we don't want anybody to be uncomfortable, do we?
Not in church.
Not in church. I think we only talk about money when we don't have any other choice. At least that's our family's philosophy. I don't think I have ever come back from a meeting with our accountant and said, Kevin, we need to talk about money, and he smiled. I mean, you know, it's just what we do. But you know what? We have a model. Somebody who talked a whole lot about money.
Yes, ma'am.
Who?
Jesus.
Thank you. That was in the Bible.
Somewhere. In the second half.
Well, there's money in the first half, too.
Just not Jesus.
The reason that Jesus was talking about money, I've been studying on this and reading on this, and the reason he was talking about money was because the people he was talking to did not have any of it. They were slaves in that society, and the women were at the very bottom of that society. They had no money, they had no power, and Jesus came in with a new story. We're afraid to talk about money because we're talking too much. And we need to be talking to people. And we need to be, I had a conversation last night with somebody. I've decided that theology, that we, those of us who have been to seminary, that the theology we learned in seminary is as useless to us as pastors as the Greek we learned in seminary. We're not going to use it. We're just going to tell happy stories or something. I'm not even sure anymore. I told Tim a few minutes ago I'm in a terrible place to be, terrible time and place to be talking about this because I'm so worked up about it. Because we've really got to start telling the truth about what's going on with money. And a guy some of us love to hate named Paul came along right after Jesus and got that story. And he was a person of means, but he saw through that story and said, there is no slave nor free. There is no male nor female. There is no Jew nor Greek. We're all in this together. They were brothers and sisters. They weren't strangers. Everyone was offered healing. Everyone was offered food. Everyone was offered resurrection, regardless of their status, because they had nothing else. And Acts tells us what I think may be the most damaging piece of scripture about money in all of the canon, and there are a lot, that they held everything in common and gave to the one who needed it. And they did that because it was so bad. They had no other way out. It was the end of the world to them. It was over. It was a horrible time. And they needed that hope. They couldn't imagine another way out. So now I'm going to skip 2,000 years of church history where we go in and out of that story over and over. And we look at that scripture. They held everything in common and gave to the one in need. And we go, I've got mine. I've worked hard for mine. I've been working for a long time for mine. I'll give you 10% after taxes. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to give 10% after taxes to away, and the church will get some of it. Mm-hmm. And the Red Cross will get it. Seriously, do you think we're going to do this? Are we going to hold things in common? How badly does that scare us? Mm-hmm. It scares me. So I'm going to skip back to 2008 when we started SoCap. And I need a drink of water.
Ramal's getting it.
Okay, thank you.
We noticed.
Good. He's preached or something before. It got started because rapacious capitalism in 2008 mm-hmm. was so bad that the banks were failing. Mm-hmm. And Kevin and I and a couple of other people had some ideas about that, about impact investing and coming out of Silicon Valley. And we were wondering what we would be able to do about it. Would people want to come to a conference?
You can at least, there's more coming, but you can have
okay.
the rest of that.
I'll take some of Anna's. Thank you.
You're welcome. Gave to the one in need.
She gave to the one in need. We held everything
in common.
Yes, we did. So we announced that we were going to have this conference. We were hoping for 200 or 300 people, and Lehman Brothers failed. And in the next 2 weeks, 400 people signed up for a conference because they saw the end of the world. We have to have a better way. Rapacious capitalism is raping the world, and we hear it every day. We hear every day. What, you know, 5 years ago we heard 5% of the people in the world have 90% of the wealth, and now it's 4% of the people of the world have 92% of the wealth, and the number just keeps going and going and going. And the worse it gets, the closer we get to the death of the economy, the more the church needs to speak to this mm-hmm. and tell people the truth about why the economy is failing. Mm-hmm. And our most recent outrageous event happened 2 days ago. Do I need to tell anybody in this room what happened? When the man who holds that office of president of what used to be the greatest country in the world said that we have to pull out of an accord that has hope of saving something for all of us because it cost us too much. This is an opportunity, folks. We have a preaching opportunity, and we have an opportunity in our lives, and I've seen it on my friends on Facebook in the last 48 hours, over and over and over. If the United States is not going to do this, then I have to stop using less gasoline. Mm-hmm. If the United States is not going to do this, then I have to make a change in my life. It is an opportunity for us. The end of the world is an opportunity. Are we ready yet? Are we ready yet to listen to that passage from Acts? That we hold everything in common and give to whoever is in need. I don't know whether we even have to listen to it. One of the people that I listen to the most with welcome ears is this poet named Wendell Berry, who basically, in reading his work, it doesn't matter whether we believe it or practice it or not, y'all, it's true. Mm-hmm. We do hold everything in common. Mm-hmm. And the Paris Accord is going to be the thing that will maybe get our attention. But what is it going to take for us to change our ways? What's it going to take for us to really do something different? When will those of us who are preachers be willing to preach it from the pulpit? Right. When will the people in the pews be ready to hear it? And what will get us to actually do something different? I've had the extraordinary good fortune over the last few years to be in, to some extent, on a speaking circuit with some folks who've given me great energy in this work. And you've heard from two of them today, Derek Brazil from Cincinnati and Tim, who is my colleague and partner in this church work. We've been bringing people together to have conversations similar to the one we're having right here for several years now. And just because Tim had this crazy idea that he wanted to get to put on a conference that had Peter Block at it, we decided to do this event in Louisville, Kentucky, which was close enough to get Peter to drive to. Peter's one of the folks who helped invent asset-based community development. And in Cincinnati, which is his home, he has been a part of building a community known as the Economics of Compassion Initiative. He's a community builder extraordinaire, and by his own admission, he's a secular Jew who says he doesn't understand the church at all, and who could blame him. But he's built from mostly church people in Cincinnati a group of people who are actively tackling that question: how do we change the economy of our city from an economy of greed to an economy of compassion? And then the other person in this group that was really why Tim wanted to have this event was because Walter Brueggemann's a good friend of Peter Block's. And Walter has kind of taken the role of theologian in residence to the work in Cincinnati. And we've been privileged to sit with him and to listen to him and talk to him, to ask him questions, and to introduce him to the SOCAP community, and to watch people's eyes and hearts and ears open when he tells that old story of the economics of greed through the pharaohs, the story of the pharaohs and the enslavement of the children of Israel, and how the pharaoh wanted everything, everything. And that the rules that were given by God to the Israelites to teach them, rather than falling into that economy of the pharaohs to an economy of compassion, economy after that liberation. That liberation speaks specifically to economic provisions and how we're supposed to treat our neighbors. That's where we get, don't charge them interest. You can charge strangers interest, but don't charge your friends and neighbors interest. Don't have two sets of weights and measures in deciding how much people will pay you. One set for the rich and one set for the poor. Walter says that for all of us, we're the rich. Mm-hmm. We know that. We're able to go to the loan to the bank for the most part and get a loan these days for 3 or 4%. And our neighbors who are living at the bottom of the economic pyramid, perhaps cleaning our houses or working at, don't get me started, Walmart, they're going to a payday lender to get an 18% loan against their checks. That is a very specific example of different weights and measures. Mm-hmm. And there are people in our churches who own payday lending mm-hmm. places, and we sit and say nothing. We're not supposed to do that. We're not supposed to collect collateral when we loan somebody some money. There is one example, one exception to that. You can take someone's coat, but you have to give it back to them at the end of the day, and then you can go back and get it in the morning. So that's just kind of fascinating to me, that the rules about collecting collateral make it as onerous to the person loaning as it is to the person getting it. And the Israelites were told something else. When they harvested their grain, they were supposed to leave enough in the fields for the orphans, the widows, and the immigrants to have enough to bake their bread to. One of the fascinating things about that to me was that 10% was usually left around the edges of the field. And the metaphor that builds for me about the edges of, as you were talking to him about that edge where things meet, is where the rich conversations happen. It's where we come together. It's where change happens. When we pay attention to what the other needs. When they harvested their olives, they were supposed to leave enough in the trees for the widows and the orphans and the immigrants. They were never to be so greedy with their own possessions that there was not enough for the widow, the orphan, or the immigrant. They would always remember that in their previous life in Egypt, that they were victims of a predatory economy too, and that they should work to make sure that mm-hmm. their community did not reinvent this predatory economy. And most astounding of all, they were told that once every set of books, Walter Brook says that when Jesus said the poor will be always with you, that he was referring to this, that there will be people who will get into debt. There will be people who cannot pay their debts. There will always be poor people, and we are to make provision for that every 7 years. cancel their debts. Let's start over. As long as we have those predatory practices, the poor will always be enslaved. And we have to keep devising over and over and over again, revising over and over again. Deuteronomic law was a revision of the law, saying, no, this isn't quite working. We need a new way to do this. And Walter says, we need our own revised standard. We've got to reinvent the economy in a way that works for all of us. Mm-hmm. Because we were once poor and enslaved in Egypt, and no way out, and God came to our rescue. We must remember that. We were once the alien, we were once the immigrant, and God provided for us, and we must go and do likewise. I think that we are at a very precipitous time in human history, in this country in particular, and we've been there before. We were there in Egypt, we were there in first century Palestine, we've been enslaved by the Roman Empire, and we have let this government in this country enslave the poor. In my tradition, the Episcopal Church owns a piece of that. But we also own a piece of its founding to a rebellion against the Roman churches wanting to build more buildings on the back of the poor. And we said no to that. The Episcopal Church, my tradition, has stepped in and preached emancipation of the slaves. We were a little slow on it, but we got there. The Anglican Church in England was stepping in on the practices of the sugar trade and refusing to buy sugar. The church women in the basements there said, no, this doesn't work. The fight for women's right to citizenship and vote, there are examples where the church has stepped in and made a difference. And we have to, as people of faith and people who have to deal with that money, imagine new ways to create systems that work for the people on the outside. We must start demanding that the church stand up to the stupid, milquetoast, right-wing Christianity that has destroyed this country.
Yes.
And is in the process of destroying this world. And until we get in there with the teachings of Jesus and with the teachings of Deuteronomy and start talking about what will save this world economically, they are going to rule the day. Pound it, my boy.
Preach.
Now, some of you are thinking, I am sure, that this is so complicated that and tedious, there's no point in talking about it. And as we're talking about it, or as we're sitting here not doing anything about it, it's going to go from 2% of the people owning 98% of the wealth to 1% of the people owning 100% of the wealth. We are going to be at the end of the world. We're going to be with the pharaohs. We are going to be in the first century Palestine. We are going to be there. And we have the story to change it. And we as Christians can't live quietly in a society that routinely imprisons, or worse, people of color for minor infractions of the law, while people with debt walk free. We have to expand the law. We have to revise the law. We have to develop ways just as they did in New Testament times, where we hold everything in common, where the people who sit in the pews know we hold everything in common. We have to keep reminding people about what was happening in the Deuteronomic times and how something was always saved. There was a bigger picture. And while I know there are days that I can't imagine what it is I can do to stop this rapacious capitalism and turn this around, I can and you can look at any newspaper in this land and know that as impossible as it is for us to imagine doing something about it, and it is impossible to imagine doing something about it, we don't have a choice. Mm-hmm. We cannot follow Jesus and opt out of this conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it means pissing off people in the pews.
Mm-hmm.
Or being thought too radical. Or mm-hmm. having friends misunderstand us. We have to imagine that new way. We have to revise. We have to leave out grapes. We have to leave out wheat. We have to leave out olives. We can't have two sets of rules about money. We have to remember that we were once slaves and stop participating. If we won't, who will? That's all I got to say. Question to me is to talk more about SOCAP, because one of the I spoke at the Vatican either right before or right after the election, immediately after the election, and I didn't take a step back at all on that, and I was asked specifically. This conference was put on by the Pontifical Council for Justice and Peace. They have given me a medal. I have a medal of honor for having spoken there. And it's all very bizarre. I did decide, even though they asked me as the producer of SOCAP to speak, not as a priest in the Episcopal Church, that I did go dressed as an Episcopal priest. And I had several people come up to me and thank me for being there as a female clergy person. But I was on a panel of people. We each spoke and then had a conversation around the topic of where do we see hope, and they were all people who were doing specific things. And I was invited there because I was the producer of SOCAP. And one other story about SOCAP that is fascinating to me is that, I told some of these same stories there, but about every other year we'll have a clergy cohort at SOCAP, and we're talking to Ramal about doing that again this coming year. And one of the first years that we did this clergy cohort, we would gather for breakfast every morning, and going to SOCAP, if you're not careful, is like drinking from a fire hose, mm-hmm. because we have 300 sessions, and you can really get in the weeds fast about appropriate amounts of how to measure what you're doing and how much interest you should make, and you know how to pick the entrepreneurs and all that kind of stuff. And so the pastors who were there were looking at it and feeling a little overwhelmed, but then one of them said, but I have to say that what the people here are doing, people who are choosing to loan money at below interest rates to entrepreneurs that are doing good, that are building businesses that focus on social issues rather than businesses just to make money, the businesses that are featured there are businesses that are for profit, but they have to be solving a social problem for people or poverty or planet. That one of the guys stood up and said, I don't know what we're doing in the church. You're building the kingdom of God. And they could see one after another and hear story after story after story of entrepreneurs who were doing work that was changing the world, that were going to eliminate anemia in India with different techniques of growing rice, with just amazing stories that people were thinking big and eliminating poverty, that they had huge goals and ideals. And we've come to realize over this 10 years of work, we're in San Francisco, so, you know, the church is like, you know, not a part of that city. And we've come to realize that the people who come to SoCal really do, you scratch the surface and you've got a person of faith, that they are really operating out of that way.
You got a question?
Yeah.
So I'm wondering where pastors go to learn how to read and interpret scripture in a way, read, interpret, and communicate scripture in a way to help members in the congregation to understand the economic vision of human life, or of Jesus for that matter. I'm a seminary professor, and I'm a pastor. What I know as a seminary professor is that most people come to seminary these days not knowing scripture hardly at all. And they come out of congregations. What they have are popular statements that they've heard from famous pastors. What they have is a theology that they constructed, in their friendship groups. Or on the street, is not related to Christian tradition, really. I think something new is actually emerging, more eclectic kind of theological vision that really does not include justice the way that I'm over 60, is in a way that somebody my age would understand justice.
Yes.
It's event-driven and not a theological vision or passion for ministry. So I'm just wondering where people go to get what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Because it's one thing to say do it, it's another thing to teach people how to do it.
Right. Tim and I are looking at each other like this is the question. it really is the question. And I'm personally looking more at the whole discipline of eschatology and trying to ask where is this leading us? Whatever we, to ask that question over and over, whatever we preach is, where is it going to lead us? How's it going to end if we go down this path? And I think those are some of the questions that need to be asked. I think somebody, and I was thinking about this yesterday, Tim, I spoke at an event for him a couple of months ago, and we had a 3-month promise that we made to the group of something we were going to do.
Yes.
And I have agreed to take 13 passages in the Revised Common Lectionary, not during stewardship season, and outline how to preach about money. And I really think we have to challenge people to preach about money and to really get in there and refuse to say we don't talk about money. We do talk about money because we have to.
Do you feel like a part of the challenge there is not just a theology around money, but the narrative that clergy bring to scripture? So if you have a scarcity mindset, you're gonna see scripture through the lens of scarcity. And if you're looking for liberation, you'll find liberation. It's based on who you are when you show up to the book to some degree too, that will impact how you interpret it.
Yes, I agree with that. I think the biggest issue we have right now is that we've let the secular world take the conversation about money. And the reason I have, if you had asked me what I think money is right now, I think money right now is a tool for rich people to get more money. And we have to take back that conversation and say that money is a resource for all of us. And one of the things for me is I am a physical body right here, and I can, the illustration I love, and I may have used it with you before, is I can slap Anna and hurt her with my hand, and you'll go, oh, that's wrong. But if I buy something with a $10 bill out of my iPad or any of the things that I own, that I know the people who are mining the minerals that are hurting them, we don't want to talk about that. And our money ethical footprint of what we do in the world is much huger, much bigger than our ethical footprint of what we do with our bodies.
So in a sense, even in the church, we benefit from oppression, so we ignore it.
Yeah. 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 Wow.
You have a question up here,
stung a little.
And then one back here. Do you remember all of them?
No.
I told you to ask.
No.
Like Tim said, next.
I actually think if, I mean, where I am right now is that if just a few of us can start talking about this, that when the crash happens that's coming, if we keep going down this path, then we can spread. Because I don't know how we're going to fight right now. Yeah. Yeah.
Question over here.
I wanted to kind of talk a little bit about the idea of running the church. As a seminary professor who teaches community development, I spend a lot of time beating my head against the wall because my work is optional. And I am sensationalized.
Grading is required in your office.
Right. Yeah,
okay.
So I am sensationalized as the seminary professor who goes and marches and protests and shows up the Capitol, and it's not essential. And so the work I've been doing challenges the idea of salvation, because I think we develop this narrative where we say this is salvation, especially in the white evangelical church, and we then say other things like social gospel is an option. And I think as I'm listening to you talk, I'm thinking this about money. And I have this now hermeneutic of suspicion that I want to question the church and say, well, sure, if we talk about money and we talk about what we should really do about money, what the Bible really says to do about money, then that means that 10% is not going to build a building that, or to support clergy, or it's actually doing kingdom work.
Yes.
And so, you know, if we employ that hermeneutic of suspicion, then we all of a sudden say, well, the church is morally vulnerable for this distortion. And so I'm just going to sit with that a while. Mm-hmm.
The church is morally culpable for many things.
I don't know how
the church is morally culpable for slavery.
I think we have to get to the point where it's not optional.
Right.
But what, I mean, we've let that happen.
Right.
And it was just in the last month that I woke up and realized that for 95% of the sermons I hear, the pastors that were preaching them might as well, if we're actually using theology as much as they were using curriculum and writing those sermons. And I think we really have to get back to a different kind of theological education. I mean, we call it theological education, and we're actually teaching how to run churches. Okay,
Kevin. Question about the reinterpretation of the Bible by the church. So this, in Mississippi, in the Encyclopedia of Religion in the South, the Baptists wanted to preach to the slaves, and the Episcopal owners said you can do it on two conditions, that Exodus has to be spiritual, not let my people go, and that you can't talk about Jubilee. It's written down, it's a bargain. So they only talked about a personal salvation. And Robert Moses in 1963, during the Freedom Summer, came up with a curriculum so the church could reclaim Exodus as meaning let my people go. So it happened to be the reporter writing about that. And so they had to go into every church and say, no, this means us. It's not, you know, it's not chariots. It's us now walking. And then the other thing that was, we were, well, the Habitat for Humanity in Jackson, and every church is involved, the junior league is involved, the law firms are involved, building houses. The last group to build a house was First Baptist Jackson. And when they got up there, after the junior league had done it, after the insurance defense law firms had done it, you know, they said, you're probably wondering why First Baptist Church is building a house. Because they had, because when they bought into a personal salvation, they couldn't take that other people out. They got pressured to do it, but they didn't know why they could do it. Because they actually signed the devil's bargain document in the 1700s. It's in that book. You can only, by limiting what they could tell other people, their story for themselves got limited.
I really think we have to go back to Acts and really look at the context in which Jesus was talking and what was Jesus doing.
His parable is also
there. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's like, what was that society like, and why was he teaching it, and why did it work? Yes.
Thurman had, how Thurman had Jesus disinherited.
Yeah.
Has that. Focus you're talking about, because he talks about the fact that he only heard five sermons at max in his lifetime where where preachers preached from the context of someone who had their back against the wall. Mm-hmm. And how we as a church have completely gotten away from even understanding Jesus as someone who lived every day with his back against the wall. And that then informs the economic conversation as well, about this, everyone's price.
I just, as you were talking, I was a song. The song was singing at Episcopal Church. I want to walk as a child of the Lord. I want to be like Jesus. No. I don't want to have that.
Got questions for your right.
Okay. Yes.
And then last one in the back.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your presentation. Thank you for the work that you're doing. I think we can get very overwhelmed by the dominant narrative right now, given the person who's in the White House and the influence of the so-called evangelical right. I think we should keep encouraging ourselves to be in solidarity. I think there are some great organizations that are doing some work. I mean, I'm encouraged that, for instance, William Barber is leaving his post at the NAACP to pick up the mantle that had been dropped of Poor People's Campaign. And I think that there's enough stuff there that we would recover. I mean, it's a shame that Martin Luther King has been domesticated as a dreamer. First of all, people only look at the whole speech, and then the fact that King really became dangerous in his last couple of years because he talked about the marriage of the triple evils of racism, militarism, and capitalism. Right?
Exactly. And so, and Beloved Community, his work on Beloved Community, capitalism was widened.
Exactly. Yeah. So I mean, I think. If you just grab a hold of that overarching narrative and begin to superimpose that on what's happening today, I think we've got an opportunity to build a real movement. You know, so I think that we should encourage each other. And to the brother's question, because I've been a seminary professor, you know, we have to help people understand that our students are not just exegeting the Bible; they have to exegete the culture.
Yes.
And it's our job to help them understand how the church got in bed with capitalism.
And this may seem trivial, but I actually think it's really important. And sometimes when I give a talk like this, I say, you know, people say, well, I don't want to preach about money because I'm not any good at money. And I said, well, you know, we preach about sin, and we know we're sinners. And I don't know what it is about our culture and money that makes me think, as I do regularly, that y'all are going to evaluate my Kohan shoes and my whatever label shirt I have on, and that I need to get up here dressed like John the Baptist in order to be listened to. And we've all got, I mean, AA, progress not perfection, you know, this thing, it's a very complicated story, And we have to find that place where we're willing to talk about the story even though we're not living it 100%. If we're living it 1% or 2% or 3%, you know, and we look at movements and we know that the leaders of movements weren't perfect. You know, we have Jesus, we believe, walks. But other than that, you know, we've just got to be willing to call it out even though we're participating in it. And we are all participating.
We have one last question here.
Well, this is not a question, but it is. I wanted to let you know that I appreciate you bringing this subject up, talking to us about, you know, we need to talk about money. And I would like to give my pastor, Pastor Taylor Nanette Gadsden, kudos because she does preach about tithing. She preaches about money. She has taught us a lot about finances. And so I can say that she is one pastor that I know of that is not afraid to speak about money.
Let's thank all of you.